I know that we are behind the schedule, but I will try to be very quick. But I will ask for a favor. Usually when I start talking about cultural competence, I get very enthusiastic and I can talk for hours. So if you can stop me in 10 minutes, that would be 10 minutes. I am not going to talk about this because I think that Sana has explained a little bit. But I want to mention this. When we started working in cultural competence back in 2012, we first tried to understand what cultural competence mean for us, how we can approach this, and what are the elements of dimensions of cultural competence. But before I explain that, let me also explain that I split in between veterinary science and SOLS, so I am teaching in different programs there. Now I am going to talk about a SOLS program. So in relation to these three dimensions, we identified that one of them is that aspect relevant just for cultural competence, for interactions with people, with different social and cultural groups. The other one was relevant for indigenous knowledge systems, about the traditional knowledge, not only of Aboriginal Australians, but knowledge from other cultures from across the world. And the other dimension of cultural competence was related to the opportunities for the disciplines to contribute towards community needs and interests. Sometimes people call this the core business of the community work, or the core business of the discipline working in those communities. Also, we established some kind, just to give a little bit of background, some kind of a graduate quality that we want to embed in one of these programs called the Animal or Veterinary Bioscience Program, ABVS. And we try to understand how we can embed cultural competence, so we outline some kind of graduate quality that guide us through this process. And also we establish some kind of considerations for the designing and embedding of cultural competence. One of them, for instance, was scaffolding across the degree, and the other one will reach maximum number of students within the degree. So we try to focus on some unit of studies that could have a broader impact. Before I explain the case studies, I just want to tell you the overall outcomes. In the animal science program, we have embedded cultural competence in 5 units of studies explicitly there. This corresponds to nearly 24 hours of teaching. And it's not only about cultural competence dimension, it's about indigenous knowledge dimension. If we focus on the ABVS, also we need to say that other programs are benefiting from this. We are talking about the agricultural programs in the first year unit where we teach cultural competence, about the veterinary biology programs and other programs who are enrolled in those units of studies. We have made evident the learning outcomes and assessment and also evaluation where it's possible about what we do in cultural competence in this unit of studies. Also, we have developed different kind of resources, not only the material that we produce for the classes, but also an open learning environment that this year we have 50 students that is focuses on cultural competence in natural sciences. We have material from the indigenous seminar that we organize every year. It's material that any academic can access. And also I have been collecting, I want to mention this, since 2012 I have done everything possible to buy as many books I can in different areas of science that academics can borrow from me. Of course, this belongs to the university, in astronomy, in environment, in different areas, to see the relevance for the disciplines, how we can possibly check whether there is some kind of content that could be relevant for discipline and we can embed in our disciplines in this area. So what we have done in the ABVS, basically we have focusing on indigenous knowledge systems and also the practices and try to find the bridges of these practices and knowledges with the Western science. We don't want to have an exclusion here. What we want to present is a bridge between Western science and indigenous ways of knowing. And also we try to embed in some cases opportunities in terms of the core business of the faculty in relation to feral animals control, how indigenous knowledge systems or indigenous practices and Western science can get together to solve some important problems for the communities. This is an example of the content map for the ABVS program. I know that there are curriculum changes that I haven't acknowledged here, but It is important to see that we have 4 gears, and we try to have a vertical integration here of some aspects relevant to the environment and animals. And we move from the first gear talking about, for instance, in animals and us, about perceptions about and use of animals. Also, we have animal management unit, I think, if I am correct, where we talk about the management of animals. And we try to show the two perspectives, giving the relevance to the topic of the core business of that unit of study, and then bring into the picture the indigenous perspective. So we are raising awareness of the indigenous knowledge system that can be incorporated into that particular unit of study. Examples, this is one that we have in a unit in year 4 that called Wildlife and Evolutionary Genetics. This unit will become the 3rd year unit of study. And we have 14 hours of teaching and co-teaching with indigenous scholars. And I want to highlight co-teaching because there are areas of indigenous knowledge system that we shouldn't be teaching. Otherwise, could be considered cultural appropriation. It's very important. Although we can develop some resources in collaboration with indigenous people and use those resources. So the things, for instance, in one of the hours was about food, in which animals are acceptable to eat in different cultures. And we have a very nice barbecue, for instance, with native food. And this native food was the excuse to talk about the different knowledge, the range of knowledge that indigenous people have about that food. And that was part of the cultural competence and how they perceive those animals and plants in those communities. In terms of the approach, we have individual group-based work and discussion and a lot of reflection, and also we have a tribal warrior cruise. And in this cruise, it's very important because it's a direct contact with indigenous people showing students about the history of indigenous people's insignia. And we went to I don't remember the name of the island, but a nice island, and we were dancing there, and we have been doing that for the last 3-4 years. In terms of the assessment, we embed specific learning outcomes, and I use multiple choice questions. I know that some people may challenge this, but we found ways of having very reflective cues in terms of the final exam, and students like that, and we use case studies. That is the first case study. The second one is a little bit technical here, but it's about how to bridge cultural competence with genetics, possibly the challenges that some people may have in their own disciplines, how to bridge cultural competence with physics, or with astronomy, or with chemistry. Here is with genetics. So what we did, for instance, is to discuss in this unit of study how genetics is used to assess the genetic origins of animals and the geographical origins of animals using genetics. Once we discuss that, we start reflecting about the animal perceptions in those geographical areas, because people think, since we are talking about chickens, for instance, here, people may think that everyone has the same idea about chickens, but if you go across cultures, there are different ideas and perceptions, so we try to link that to cultural competence in some way. Here we work cultural awareness. And we have some kind of action-based learning and inquiry-based learning for the students, and also we have multiple choice questions and small reflective essays. All of these linked and very, very focused in terms of what we expect from the students. The third example is in terms of bridging Western science with indigenous knowledge system regarding animals and weather. When we talk about indigenous knowledge system, not only for Australia, and Western science, there are different ways of knowing. The systems are different, and it's important to get familiar with those aspects, at least the theoretical or foundational aspect of that. So what we did here was trying to show how, for instance, we could have knowledge about certain animals from a Western perspective, and then we bring into the picture how indigenous people have knowledge about those animals based on the prediction of the weather, pain of the flowering of the plants, pain of how animals move in the rivers or on the land. So that provides some kind of bridge to understand that we have, in some cases, complementary science, the Western and indigenous science, to be able to understand wildlife in a better way. Also, we talk about animal management. An example just in this, I am not sure if it's clear, this square here, this table, but we have how we perceive, for instance, decisions. We have 4, but indigenous people may have between 3, seasons to 13 or 14 seasons, depending on the calendar that they use or the region that they are. So we start having this kind of discussions and then bringing together how we can solve modern day problems with ancient and present, as well as non-ancient and present indigenous knowledge systems there. Okay, so this is the challenges. So the challenges, I want to mention one. Starting from scratch is not easy, because some of us, we are experts in genetics, we are experts in environment, in animal management, in chemistry, in physics. We haven't been taught to teach cultural competence. So self-learning is very important, a scholarship, and being part of a network, trying to have people around you or find people that can share with you that knowledge. The other aspect is in terms of the finding the relevance for the disciplines. In my experience, when I teach cultural competence as a dry content, students just look at me and say, yes, it's nice, but what? So, but when I try to show the relevance for the content of, or for the discipline or for the unit of studies, students like more this approach. And finally, I want to talk about the support. Embedding cultural competence is a little bit expensive sometimes, and for that reason is something that needs to be discussed. Because if we are going to talk about indigenous knowledge system as one of the components, not necessarily the main one, we need to pay for indigenous speakers. They don't work for free. And it's important that we acknowledge that and we have some kind of budget. I know that it doesn't depend from the Faculty of Science, but possibly depend on the DVC education, but that the academic staff have this kind of possibilities of accessing that funding. Now, with the NCCC, we have the possibility of accessing to support, to advise academics in that area. And just, I want to acknowledge Stuart Lowden, Meg Boss, and different people. Also, we have Anoli with Tina, with Peter Am, with Sana, with Gary, different people, with you too, yes, you are part of the OLI. So we have this new resource where students can learn about the fundamentals of cultural competence, but focusing on natural sciences. Yeah. Thank you.